Well, Dom, are you ready?
Oh, well, Ryan, I am ready.
I don't know what this podcast is called. In fact, we actually have a new listener. We have a lot of new listeners. I go back and look at our stats. People are always jumping on to the Ramble podcast in general. Mm-hmm. Like, it's more or less an evergreen type podcast. You know, we talk about each movie season by season. And so such a listener jumped on the podcast recently and they joined my Facebook group. And they're like, I was like, oh, you're still doing Frank, because they just started.
Because this is still going on.
Well, no, he's excited because he just started Last Blood, and we sort of started Frank in season 4. Last Blood was season 5.
Right.
And so he commented on the Facebook page. He's like, oh, man, you guys are still doing Frank. He said, is this now a Frank Stallone podcast?
Basically, when's the last time? I don't even remember the last time we talked about Rambo.
We'll get there. We're going to get there eventually, folks. Anyways, I thought that was really great. People are enjoying. I'm telling you right now, there are more downloads for the Frank. There's double the downloads for the Frank coverage than
double the downloads, like it.
Than the when we had the Rambo at the end type thing with the cartoon, I should say, the cartoon ones. Yeah.
Right.
So basically we're almost sitting at just below the same numbers we did when we're just covering the film. So there's like a good two-thirds of our listeners have continued with the Frank coverage.
They've gone on the journey with us.
Well, they've gone for the Rambo films to the Frank Stallone coverage. All right. So without further ado, shall we?
And here's another segment of Frank Stallone. Who is this guy?
You know, I will say this, Dom. I don't think we'll ever get a better intro music.
No, I don't think so. You can't top, you know, the Fall From Over remix. You just can't do it.
Frank could also not top that song. Okay, well, today's a special episode because Frank Stallone was on another podcast, Dom.
Yet again, another podcast. He is a busy man, Frank Stallone. He won't come on this podcast, but...
No, he won't. And I will say this too about his Instagram. I've been kind of tracking his Instagram. Have you noticed the depletion in videos that he's dropping lately?
Yeah.
Are we in his head? Are we in his head a little bit?
I think we're psyching him out. I think like the boxing analogy, I think we're psyching him out. We're getting into the fight.
He stopped talking about boxing. He doesn't talk about his workouts lately. He's taking away our content. Frank, he's killing us from the inside, dog.
That's what he's doing. It's actually like the smartest thing ever. He's doing like a Usual Suspects on us when it's just all going to make sense. Like,
his Instagram is nothing more. It's not the boxing analogies or the workout routines. It's very low key, very infrequent postings. I don't know. Maybe I'm reading too much. We know he has watched the show. So he might be having to figure out how do I post a video without Dom and Ryan and criticizing it?
Guys can't make fun of.
Mr. Frank Stallone, today was not your lucky day because you were a guest on a podcast. The Cowsills Podcast. Have you ever heard of this musical phenomenon group, the Cowsills?
I have never heard of them before this. I did my 5 seconds of research and I see that their most well-known song would be that Flower Girl song.
That's their biggest hit.
Right.
It never even reached number one. So that's one thing that Frank Stallone has on them, I think. I think Frank Stallone's song did hit number one. It was on the charts. Okay. He mentioned in this interview that it was on number one for eight weeks in a row or something like that. So the Cowsills, they were a family group, a la Partridge Family type styling group. It was formed by the mother. Her 4 or 5 sons played various instruments. And then the youngest daughter, Susan, who's on this podcast. She joined when she was 8 years old with her brother, Paul, who's on this podcast. 3 of the brothers are now dead.
I don't know what that giggle was for.
I know, sorry.
3 of the brothers are dead.
I'm not laughing at that. It's crazy because they died of, one died of from Hurricane Katrina, one died of drug and whatever. So the family's been through some stuff, but the 3 surviving siblings, Susan, Paul, and Bob. They are the surviving members. They still do gigs. We'll get into that. So they run a podcast. They actually run a podcast, a weekly podcast. I didn't know these guys from a hole in the ground. Of course, they're much older now. And they start off the show right away. Dom, let's just do the intro. I just want you to hear how they start their podcast. Let's just say this. There's no editing involved in their show.
No editing.
I can see that would have come up somewhere. Somewhere it would have come up. Okay. Moo. Ting, 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 ting.
Welcome to the podcast.
What in blue blazes are we watching?
When I first started watching this, I was like, are they like, is this like a space podcast? Because they all have backgrounds to stars. I was like, is this an astrology podcast? I don't even know why they all have that. Very strange.
Okay, so we have the top right. If you're watching this on YouTube, you can see this, but we'll say this for our audio listeners, of course. On the top right, we have Bob. I think he might be the senior member. To our left, his right, we have Susan, but she's under her husband's name, I guess, Russ.
I was wondering about that.
And then we have Paul.
I thought it was a sex change situation. I thought it was
fun. No, it's Susan. And Susan is baddie.
Yeah.
Would you describe the same? Okay. Mm-hmm. That was the bird noises she was making. I don't get it. She was making bird noises. So they start off right away, Dom. They start talking to their listeners right away, talking about how they just got off the phone with some big-time producers who want to make the Cowsills into a reality show. Did you catch any of that?
Yeah, I did.
We were thinking, could you guys out there, Cowsills?
So they're talking about how, I don't know who this group is or who this company is, but they said, we want to do a reality show with you guys. Now, I'm not sure if that's exactly what they said. Like a reality show would be like the Family Stallone show. That's a legit, or the Kardashians. These are legit type, you know, follow the family around. I can't imagine, Dom, there's an audience for these people enough to warrant an actual Paramount Plus type styling reality.
Yeah, I don't think so. I don't know them well, but from the looks of it, I mean, I don't think it would be that entertaining.
Well, it might be entertaining for the wrong reason. They kind of talk about the format of the show, and I'm thinking they're maybe misunderstanding what's happening, but Paul is the most childlike version of this group. Even though he might be 80, he acts very childlike. Well, no, sorry. Susan does too. I don't know. These two are just... Paul is now going to talk to you, us, the audience, about ways they can help with the reality show.
If you guys could come up with some kind of scenario to put the three of us in, you know, the Cowsills in the scenario that you think would work in this day and age, you know, because we're just trying to think of... You know, they're saying, yeah, just do special things. Well, we don't know about special things. So maybe you could tell us what would be special things on our podcast that you guys would go, wow, how special is that?
So we're supposed to give them ideas to do things in their show. Now, granted, that's what happens in reality shows, i.e. the Family Stallone. Like Stallone took his two daughters to a self-defense class.
So, it's like a sitcom situation almost.
Yeah, well, that's what reality shows are. They're situational comedy or reality. So obviously, without the cameras, would have Stallone taken his two youngest daughters to that defense class? Unlikely. But for the reality show, he did. So you're seeing the reality of them in that class situation, but Stallone probably wouldn't have taken them to the class without the show.
Right.
So this is kind of what they're going for here as well. They come up with some of their own ideas, and it just kind of gets worse.
They want us to move, keep the podcast, but their idea is to move it over to YouTube with increased content, okay? They want more than just an interview or just a visit between the three of us.
What are they going to start doing? They're going to start doing prank videos like Jackass or something, doing stunts?
Almost. First, they talk about they can make money off this. This is going to be a money-making machine. They're excited about that.
Charming and hilarious and fun to add on this other separate place where we'll have extra content to get us to where we want to go so we can honor our legacy and have a show at the end of our lives.
Yeah, and they're talking that move to YouTube with content off of the podcast. Y'all will have to pay like $1 or $2.
Patreon.
It'll be a monetization, huh?
Patreon is one of the formats that YouTube, Patreon.
Again, they're saying that we're going to move to YouTube. I got this video from YouTube. They're already on YouTube.
Surprise. Cowswells, whatever the fuck it is.
Cowsills. So we're going to move from YouTube with extra content that isn't this. They all live in separate states, Dom.
Okay.
They don't even live together. So I'm not sure how they're going to do this reality show together.
This is going to be the reality show. It's just going to be them like this.
Susan, she's the youngest of the siblings. So she's only 65 or 66 years. So she's the young body here.
She's only 800 this one. She's the youngest.
So she's the draw for the men, right? The simps right, would be course, drawn to her. You get what's called the Susan tiers. Now, tiers is T-I-E-R-S. So the levels, Susan levels or tiers in Patreon. So they're going to talk about that.
And within that, you can even have a tier. You have a tier there where this level, well, you just get that. Susan's got a problem. The next level, Susan's crashing. The third level, okay, what happened to Susan? You know, so
what? It's like a murder mystery they're going for.
Well, they keep talking about Susan crashing at her car or after she comes off her drugs. I'm not sure. So they're talking about how there's different tiers. You'll see Susan in trouble, and that's tier one. Tier two is, what does Susan do when she's in trouble? And then tier three is, how does she get out of that?
Tier four, somebody's holding a gun to Susan's head.
The camera's on in the bus, okay? And then all of a sudden, we get a call, okay? And it's a call. And you look and you go, oh, my God. And the call could be whatever. We could make up the call, who it was, and then create around this call. You know, trouble. You know, somebody had a crash, or I mean, I hate to say that.
Somebody had a flat tire and doesn't know how to proceed. You're going to help.
Yeah.
This is their content, Dom. They're on the tour bus. The phone rings, whether it's fake or real. They even say that. The phone rings and gives them a scenario. Susan's tire is flat. We got to go change it, but we don't know how.
That's. Sounds awful. I'll be honest, it sounds awful.
Well, they have some other ideas. It's not over yet. They talk about some of the outfits they can wear, some of the silly outfits they can wear.
We could dress up in little kid outfits.
Whoa.
They go back to the phone call thing again. Here it is.
Whatever that phone call is what the show's about.
Well, I won't be going getting any early phone calls then because I don't want to do that episode.
Hey, no, that's the story. It's for Susan. Oh, no. Hey,
but guys, wait. We said when we were approached by B that we were not interested in a reality TV show like that. And he said he wasn't either because what he
loved, but we might have to bring him back that way.
They're really obsessed with the phone call. Oh, you think it's over, Dom? No, there's another phone call idea.
On the other side of that line and start writing all the funny things that could come in on a phone call that we could do.
We can make them up.
Yeah, we can make episodes that way. That's what I'm going
to
do.
It keeps going back to the phone call.
He's obsessed with the phone call. Now, one last thing they want to do. This is all before, of course, Frank is introduced. One last thing they're obsessed with doing. I haven't listened to their podcast, but they seem to think, Dom, that if they get a hold of Jimmy Fallon, that Jimmy Fallon will bring them on his show and they'll become superstars again. Because they haven't been relevant. You got to keep in mind, they haven't been relevant in 52 years. Their last kind of hit was 1972. And they've done carnivals and
vacant lots. They've been playing vacant lots a lot.
So it's been 52 years. But they're somehow convinced that if Jimmy Fallon sees them, it's back to 1965. Here we come.
Position on your Fallon idea, and just if new listeners, Susan's idea is that we show up in front of the MB, wherever he films his show, Fallon, with our guitar and ourselves and our sign saying, you have us on. Now they're saying, we got to do that ourselves and film it. And
so this reality show, people are like, hey, that's a good idea, but you have to go do it and film it yourself.
Yeah, we don't want to have that. Basically tell them we don't want to have any part of it. You could make it and we'll watch it.
This is an absolute gong show. All I can say is I hope they get it, but there's more found. The found's not over yet.
Comes out of that door with a camera and starts asking us, what the hell are you people doing?
Hi.
And then Jimmy will be there and we'll hear him. He'll go, all right, bring him in. Come in, Jesus
this
Christ.
Get
him
off my sidewalk. He won't be able to. He won't. If that man, I don't care. I don't know him, but I know him enough from his show that if he literally sees with his eyes,
he'll see with his eyes as opposed to seeing with his mouth. But he'll see with his eyes that they're out there with signs. Hey, we're the Cowsills, Jimmy.
Yeah.
Let us. Are they all there functioning?
The stuff they're saying is so bad that I don't even know if it's actually like, is it a spoof? Is this like a parody?
You're assuming they're bright enough to come up with a spoof. You're assuming too much. There's no way. Now, are they trolling us? No, they're not clever enough to troll their listeners. Right. You got to keep in mind their fans are their age. They're 75-year-old people. They're not going to get this humor if it's a joke. They're serious. They're talking about going to Jimmy Fallon's studios outside of his lot with signs saying, "Hey, Jimmy, have us on your show. We're the Cowsills." Jimmy's going to see that and pull them back into the studio and have them on the show, and they'll become popular again.
Not bring us in.
I love it. By the second day, I can see someone getting into his office. They won't go away, you know. So there'll be 2 days of that before the fall, someone comes out.
We'll play at the cutting room. Yes. We'll do it when we're at the cutting room.
They're tending on being there all week, and so eventually they're going to bring them in because these crazers are outside our door, Jimmy. Can we either kill them or bring them into the show? Which would you prefer?
They're going to get escorted off the streets, obviously.
Now we're going to get into the Frank. So they're about to introduce Frank, but before they do, they got word that Frank was a fan of theirs, and they're acting like, put this way, the way they're acting like Frank is a fan of theirs might be the same way that we might act had we heard that Sly liked our show. Fair enough.
Right. Yeah, there's a lot of like, they really love Frank. I got this from this interview.
Though they know nothing about him, which was very odd. Did you catch that too?
Yeah, that's true.
They didn't even know about his reality show. They didn't even know about the Family Stallone show. Okay, well, we'll get to that.
The California Music Hall of Fame. And there, waiting for us to bond with and be friends with and talk to, was Frank Stallone. And I immediately acted like a fan when I heard Frank liked us. It was like, he likes us. What do you mean? What does that mean? He likes us? Friend. Yeah, he knows who you are. And then we ended up talking to Frank, and he's going to be on the show today. It was awesome. It was awesome.
And he asked to take a picture, or we were all taking pictures. And he was like, right, standing with us, and I'm like, I'm in front of him, way too short, not looking at him. And he's like, whoa, this is great.
What? This is okay. This is embarrassing. I mean, this is really cringe.
And we've all done it. And Frank's done it. We do it. You know, we're always fighting for our legacy and ourselves. Like Paul reminded us of that, you know, that we do fight for our position. Yeah, we think we deserve.
So these Cowsills group, the reason why they relate to Frank so much, what they have in common is they both were once something 40 to 50 years ago, but it's over. And there's no, Dom, I'm not even trying to be funny.
They're fighting for their legacy.
They're fighting for their legacy. They're still wanting people to say, we love you. It's sad.
Yeah, it's
Frank does it too. They both do it. Both the Cowsills and Frank have that in common. And you'll hear it throughout the interview where they just keep talking about what once was and what could have been and maybe what should have been, but it didn't happen, where other people got what they didn't get.
Yeah, there's a lot of that from Frank, especially.
The Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, our credentials measure up to more than many of the groups that are in there.
Ooh, bold statement.
Yeah, so he's saying we're in there, great that we're there, but we deserve to be there more than other people that are there. Jeez, man, just say thank you.
You guys, absolutely. Is this like content?
Oh, this lady, she's so
opening her mail. Is this part of like a segment? She's opening her mail.
She left the camera for our listeners, went to answer the door to get her Amazon package, and she's asking, is this content for our reality show? Me opening up a package of mail?
Would I leave the podcast to go answer the door from UPS and then show what I got?
Dom, they're serious. Look at the brothers. Like, yeah, we might have something here. Let's see.
Their eyes are opening.
That means it depends on what you've got.
Yeah, this is a failed segment right now.
This whole episode is a failed segment.
Bob might be the only one with brains here. Paul and Susan are a little bit dopey. Bob's like, this will not work. This will not work for the show. True words have not been spoken, Bob. Okay. Oh, they do a little bit more family business on the air. This is just a funny little segment. They're on a podcast, no editing, obviously. We're 15 minutes into the episode. Frank Stallone is the titled guest. They've done all this reality show talk because they just got off the phone with this pretend company. And now, no, family business is not over. Here we go.
Glenn, the music guy.
No, are you watching my anybody?
Okay, because he's wanting all the chord sheets. He must have sent him something because he's only wanting We Can Fly, Love American Style, and I don't know which other one. And, you know, I wrote him and I said he wanted a set list, and I put the five hits.
This person's asking for a set list for one of their gigs. He goes, I gave him our five hits.
They play him over. They do the five, and then they do the five again, probably.
This has nothing to do with Frank or the reality show. They're literally having a business meeting in the middle of their podcast. Okay. Now we're going to get to more talk about possible content for their reality show.
I'm hoping more potential phone calls.
Their reality show should just be them on the podcast asking, can this be content for our reality
show? Is this content? Is this content?
We like just have a lovely business meeting with our castees, which we do sometimes. I tried to bring it to our attention, but you two are furious. And I think this is good content.
Susan does this throughout the whole show. She'll talk, and her microphone's not very strong. She's kind of far away from it. All you hear is she's saying batty things in the background. He's like,
they talk over each other a lot, too, I noticed.
All right, so they think that might be content. And then we have a little bit of a boomer moment coming up here. As Frank is introduced.
Where it's going to be, hey, Frank is in a window. His name is there.
Frank is coming. Frank is coming down the pike.
Frank Stallone, y'all. Frank Stallone.
He's connecting to audio. This is so exciting.
Let him get his tech. Hey. You know, he is our age. Hey, so, his Frank is red.
That's all right. He's getting his sound on. He's doing it.
This is good content. I'm trying to make it. Reality show, by the way.
This is incredible content. Look at Paul, like, looking closer at the computer screen. He's like trying to.
Is it working yet?
That's what it is. It's like he's trying to help Frank by looking.
Frank, can I help you?
Ryan, you're right over there. Is the sound working?
Hey, listen, this is what we all do. You know, remember when
people
I got
our
in-
age? I mean, there are some older folks who do know technology, but not a lot.
Yeah.
No, you're just dumb. Got nothing to do with age. You're just not very smart. Okay, we've got more content talk. Here we go. You ready?
When we make a call to, you know, somebody that we're hoping they have that same vibe, they always go, we always go, yeah, with the Cowsills, and they go, the who?
Anytime I'm reaching out to anyone, we're with the Cowsills, parentheses, a group from the 60s with the mother in it had a few hits. Close parentheses.
Again, Bob with the facts. That's all they are. They were a band from the 60s, early 70s, and that's it. Bob. And it's over. It's okay. It's okay that you did something. Don't get me wrong. It's great that you did something, but you can't rechase this legacy that you guys are talking about. It's over.
Are you guys related to the Partridge Family?
Yeah. I thought of content for our new reality show, and it's the Jonas Brothers interview we did. That would be cohesive to our life.
So she's talking about the content they could do for the show is to get up a previous interview they did 15 years ago when the Jonas Brothers interviewed them. I don't think they understand what the reality show might be.
Just let it go. You know, like you're not going to have a resurgence at this point.
No. Frank is back. He's on the show. He made it through.
First time I saw you guys, was your first show The Tonight Show?
So this is a very telling question that Frank asked, and I do love this. So Frank asked him what big shows were they on?
Or...
Mm-hmm.
Or
oh my gosh,
Frank.
No,
was it Ed? I thought it was the Tonight Show because I remember I saw you guys the first time, and you were singing "The Rain, the Park, and Other Things," but it was live.
Ed Sullivan.
Yeah,
we did it on the Tonight Show too, but live was Ed Sullivan, Frank.
And it was so. I thought it was great, man, because you know. To me, I envy you guys. There's two shows I never got to do.
He never did any talk shows. Now, he did go with David Letterman once, but he didn't perform. To be fair, he was a guest. I think he was doing a movie role at the time. Could have been a bar fly or something to that effect. But he's talking about there's two shows I never did, The Tonight Show and The Ed Sullivan Show. Well, yeah, he also didn't perform with David Letterman. He didn't perform with Conan. He didn't perform on Kimmel or Fallon or Jay Leno.
Yeah, the list goes on of shows he didn't pop on. Frank, he must have notes, Frank, because you notice he keeps looking over at like a piece of paper. He definitely wrote a couple things down to remember.
He came prepared knowing that we'd be watching this podcast. He came a little bit more prepared this time. There's no talk of any exercise regime either. He kept that right off the table. Not one.
Thank God.
Tonight Show and Ed Sullivan. Because I was too old.
Do you hear that? The reason why?
Because he was too old.
He was too old. That doesn't make sense, Dom. What's he talking about?
No. The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson was still going on into the 80s, no?
does Frank know how aging works? He was younger back then. he wasn't, Frank, you weren't 73 back then. You were 40 and 30. That's not too old to be on any of these shows. He says he was too old. Now, Susan, for whatever reason, thinks it's adorable or fun to take a picture of Frank Stallone with her cell phone from his screen to her camera. Even though she already got pictures with him.
I noticed.
You know, in those days, that was the apex. I mean, the thing is, Ed Sullivan, The Tonight Show, and American Bandstand. But by the time I did American Bandstand, 83, with...
Oh, she's so annoying. She bugs me. There's something about her that just bugs the shite out of me. she took a photo of Frank, but she made sure she was in the photo on her screen, too. So I think she's taking a photo of Frank next to her on the computer screen.
Right, right.
Dom, do you have anything before you want to talk about?
Right before, I know, I think they mentioned that he's in 60 movies. That comes back later. He corrects them with the correct number later.
Okay, on. Yeah. They did mention 60 a couple times. I think they probably stopped following his career about 20 years ago, so they stopped.
Well, a lot of people did.
They do mention 60 a couple times. I noticed that too. Here's Frank. Very little talk about his brother in this episode too. This is a fairly long podcast episode. There's very little talk about Sly, but there was talk about Sly. Don't worry. This was the nice thing that Frank had to say about Sly.
Things together, a la the Osmonds, the Everly Brothers. There's just that vocal thing that just ties in, you know what I mean?
So he's talking about how the Cowsills sound great together, and they do sound fine together. In fact, I do have a little clip I should show right now of them performing in recent years of how they sound on this big concert footage here. But they sound great. Don't get me wrong. They sound just fine live. And this is what Frank is talking about. So to be fair to the Cowsills, here's how they sound. They're singing one of their five hits here. It's called Hair. Jimmy Fallon, are you watching?
You better be watching, Jimmy Fallon. I like that the one singing, he still wears the Boston hat, even like
I think that's Paul. It's deceiving because in the video that we're watching now, he's short in the camera, but he's taller. Right, Bob is taller in the camera, but he's short.
Yes, I see
so
that.
It threw me off too, but so Paul's singing there with Susan, who did the singing, of course, there, the female voice you heard. Yeah, they sound fine live. There's singers their age who wish they could sound like this. So that's what Frank's referring to. So they're saying, as siblings, you guys sound good. So they're going to, how does Sly sound with Frank is coming up?
It's like effortless. My brother is totally tone deaf. He couldn't carry a note in a handbag. Seriously.
Oh, we had.
So he's never sung on any of your records?
Oh, God, you kidding? There's a funny story. I had no money. This was about 1978.
Isn't that still the case? Anyway. So it's just funny how you said that his brother, you know, we know that. Like, Frank, here's the thing. But what your brother can do is he can write, produce, direct, star.
But he's absolutely tone deaf. Did you hear his song from Paradise Alley?
It's such a weird flex, man. Like, yes, you have a talent that your brother doesn't have. Like, you have siblings, right?
Yes.
Is there talents that you have and maybe the others don't, or vice versa?
No, I have everything, Ryan.
Okay, fair enough. You're the sly.
They're both tone deaf, and I...
So, come up here, folks. Frank explains why he didn't succeed. One of the many reasons why. This is one of many in this episode. But this is one of the main reasons why he never became successful, like, you know, Billy Joel or Bruce Springsteen.
I didn't have no manager.
What about my part, Mick?
It was an incredible story. I mean, you're a man with a huge legacy, but all the way through it, you keep saying, yeah, and I never made it, and I never made it. You know, sure, I did this song, but then there was a 7-year lull, and so I never made it.
So they're talking about the documentary. They bring it up a couple of times. Within the documentary, yes, that's the whole point, is Frank, he never breaks out of the shadow of his brother because he only exists because of the shadow of his brother. And that's the whole point, that he has to admit that. The moment Frank admits it, then he's at peace.
Right.
But he refuses to admit that he's anything because of his brother. Dom, what he tries to do is he tries to say all these other reasons why I didn't become huge and successful. At the end of the day, Frank, you're a decent enough singer, passable guitar player who belongs in a bar, and that's it.
Right.
Why was that? The agency, the manager, what was holding you back?
You're not any good.
Yeah. Well, they're asking Frank, what was holding you back? He wasn't Billy Joel.
Yeah.
Or Elton John.
Right.
You and I are both Billy Joel fans. That's what I bring up. And mm-hmm. he was around the same time. And Bruce Springsteen, I'm a huge Bruce Springsteen.
Right.
They were same. Around the same 70s, right? They came out. Look at the artist you had to be to have the legacy that Bruce has today. And right. Billy Joel has today. It started back then with the songs and the albums they had then. That's a legacy, Frank.
There's nothing wrong with being, not even that I'd call Frank one of these, but like a one-hit wonder or something like that. There's just people that they have one song, they have two songs. Yeah. They don't have that list of songs. And it's fine.
You're right. And he hasn't embraced who he is. He keeps chasing the why and how comes. And he'll never be at peace with his life until he just admits, hey, I had what I had because of my brother. It got me somewhere for a bit. I got a couple bucks in my pocket. And just embrace life. Enjoy life. Go golfing. Right. Go to the range. Who cares? Do your Instagram. Yeah. But stop talking about what could have been.
You know what? I never really had an agency or manager. It was like, you know, it's like what you were talking about. Like you're amazed when people go, wow, I really love the Cowsills, you know, because
yeah, it's shocking.
So when Lenny Kravitz came up to me and Jim goes, hey, Matt Reid.
yeah. Lenny Kravitz came to
Lenny Kravitz came up to me in the gym. Like, oh, really?
I love your stuff.
Dig your stuff or stuff like that. And they're like, you listen to my stuff? You know what I mean? Okay. But
yeah. I don't know if Lenny Kravitz listens to Frank's stuff. I'm going to go out and a whim here. I don't know.
If we stole Lenny's phone right now, do you think any Frank Stallone would be on the playlist anywhere?
Yeah, like his whole gym workout playlist is all Frank Stallone songs.
Just look at the subtle way he tells that story. He's not even convinced. He's not even believing his own lies that Lenny said that the way he kind of says it.
Like you're amazed when people go, wow, I really love the Cowsills, you know, because
yeah, it's shocking.
So when Lenny.
Okay. Again, did you catch that subtle statement there? What he's saying is you're amazed that people say, because they don't know who you are. And so the reason why they're amazed that they say, well, I like your stuff is, oh, you know us? Amazed.
You know we exist?
Yeah. Does Bruce ever say to his wife, oh, I can't believe someone says they like my stuff today? They're almost just annoyed. It's too much. It's too many fans. Yeah, so I love how Frank has a fan, but of course the fan has to be Lenny Kravitz. It can't just be some schlub. It adds, what do you call it, a value to his stuff because Lenny likes it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Kravitz came up to me and Jim goes, hey, Matt, really dig your stuff or stuff like that. And they're like, you listen to my stuff? You know what I mean?
Okay. But we know that.
I didn't have, like most artists, and it's not – I just had no mentorship, no leadership. There was no Irving Azoffs. There was none of that stuff. So I kind of...
A lot of this segment is like him just defending why he's not more famous. I didn't have an agent. I didn't have this.
Then get one. If he really believed that's all that was missing at the time, then get one. If he thinks that isn't the case, then get one now.
Right.
Like if you know that now and you have all the talent that you think you have, then get one now. Mm-hmm. Rebuild your career now, Frank. Now he'll bring up the Rocky thing. He's going to talk about this is the biggest, I would say lie is not the right word. This is the biggest, lamest excuse he brought up regarding the very film that catapulted his brother's career. He is a residual effect of that because of his brother. Again, had Rocky never existed, Sly would still be parking cars.
Right.
Came out with my album on RCA right when Rocky came out. So,
okay. So he was with a band called Valentine. It was actually the band Valentine that sang the song Take You Back. So he fronted that band called Valentine. I believe one of the guitarists was the John Oates or Hall & Oates. One that fine. He had some like talent in his band. It was a band called Valentine, but one band of many. Again, Sylvester Stallone did not exist at this time, like in the sense that we understand him today. He released an album with Valentine in 75 in that area. Rocky comes out in 76. And this is the reason why his album did not succeed. Because this is the power that Rocky had over the industry.
It doesn't matter if I was the Eagles. Nothing could have eclipsed Rocky at that point. You know,
That's absolute bullshit. Rocky came out when? November 76.
Right.
Oh, what came out December 76? You might have heard of this album. Hotel California.
Exactly.
He should have not even mentioned the Eagles. Their biggest album was literally out the next month. Their success of that album had nothing to do with the Rocky film. And the opposite side of that coin is Valentine's not success had nothing to do with the Rocky film.
I'd actually say that him being Sylvester Stallone's brother, that should have actually catapulted him more, I think. If he ever had a better shot, that's like if my brother did something tomorrow and I released something and my brother's name's all over the world, like I should get a little bit of a boost, right?
Of course you would.
Versus like an independent band, let's say versus like another band that was releasing an album, people may be like, oh, let's give Frank Stallone a chance. So he had the opportunity.
You're absolutely right. That's what I'm getting at. He's saying that nothing could eclipse the Rocky film. And then he mentions the Eagles, which is a horrible example because the Eagles, in many ways, might have eclipsed the Rocky film to some degree. That was a huge album for them. And it's apples and oranges, too. He should have brought up another film, maybe, instead of music. But because he's in the music industry, he's equating his lack of success with other artists.
It doesn't matter if I was the Eagles. Nothing could have eclipsed Rocky at that point, you know? So
yeah, your timing sucked on that one, Franklin.
What? Valentine was released before Rocky. It was released before Rocky. The bump that Frank got in his career was because of Rocky. He's seeing literally the opposite of what happened to his career. He only has one to speak of. The only reason why he's on the Cowsills podcast as Frank Stallone is because of his brother. End of story.
Right.
He's saying had his brother never released Rocky, he would be the Eagles.
He would be the famous brother.
Absolutely asinine, insane that he thinks he's on the level of the Eagles. And not only did the Eagles come out the month after Rocky came out, let's see all these other Petrie albums and artist doms, a dom that was eclipsed by, want to hear the other artists and albums that were eclipsed by Rocky? You ready?
I can't wait.
Queen, A Day at the Races.
Oh, right, right, yeah.
Blondie, debut album, all eclipsed by Rocky.
Bad timing on David Bowie.
Bad timing. Can you imagine how good these albums would be had Rocky not been released? We got more. We got more. This is all just a few months after Rocky was released because it was in the theaters at least a year. So now we got David Bowie. He didn't go anywhere. What about Pink Floyd Animals? That was a bomb.
Never heard of him.
You might have heard of this album. Maybe you haven't. I'm not too sure. It didn't do much noise. It came out a couple months after Rocky was released. Fleetwood Mac Rumors. You ever heard of that?
What's a Fleetwood Mac?
The Clash, you might have heard the Clash debut album. Ramones, yeah, not really. How about the Sex Pistols? Their one album that no one ever listened to. These albums were all released within the window after Rocky was released and still in the theaters. Every single one of those albums, people know. The world knows. So again, Frank, what you're saying doesn't make any sense. This was an incredible year. That was an incredible 4 month stint of albums. Right. What are you talking about? What's he talking about, Dom? Help me understand.
I don't understand, honestly. And there's too much. You could tell that there was too much of a competition that he feels between him and his brother, too, where it's like, oh, I would have been more famous if he didn't do Rocky. You get those vibes from him. He's essentially saying that.
Yes, I know. Okay, so I don't want to beat that dead horse. Let's go to this. Susan puts her foot in her mouth.
Frank, I like to say at the beginning, but we're in the middle. Welcome to the Cowsill Podcast. So listen, though, what I want to know, so you're older than your brother.
No, I'm younger, actually. I'll be 74. He'll be 78.
Oh, okay. All right. So look, here's...
Oof. I don't know where she's going to go with that, but she said that Sly was the younger brother. Not only can Frank not be the brother of Sly, he's actually now the older, uglier version of Sly.
You're like, obviously the older brother.
Oh, this is very telling. Frank is blown away by how many shows they do a year. But this is very telling because he's like, you actually are able to do this many shows, i.e. people show up to your shows. Frank's blown away by this because he thinks the Cowsills might be below him. I bet you there's a part of Frank who thinks it's an honor for him to be there. I would say that the honor is actually should be Frank to be with them because the Cowsills, to their own credit, draw numbers that Frank can't draw today.
Mm-hmm. I loved it. Well, it's all hit songs. It's all like great. It's an up show. It's very well.
Somebody would tell us.
All hit songs.
And it's very well produced. The background band is great.
Yeah. You know? Yes. Oh, God. Yeah. Happy to get them.
More free in them, man.
They more
free. How many of those do you do a year? Do they go on?
Do you tour one year after another? Or is it just...
do you have an isolated show once every 5 years? Or
that's what he's asking.
So it's just summer. Just summer. We had 50 this summer. We had 59 last summer. They're one-nighters. We live on a
Yeah, they go on to 3 months.
We live now, on a bus.
When not in the summer, do you do like fairs?
Okay, so he's like, so they do. Yeah, we do 60 shows in during the summer. And his eyes, you see his eyes widen up there.
Yeah, yeah.
Like his eyes went wide, like he just got a record deal, you know. And then, and he's like, well, okay. Well, please tell me you don't do shows outside of summer. Please give me something here. Like, no, we do stuff too.
It's amusement park.
That's our full band. We have full band shows. You know, the three of us go on Happy Together. They share the band. But we have our sons in our band, and Susan's husband's our drummer.
So they play throughout the year. They have their band production, then they have their family production.
Okay, right.
I don't know why, but I thought this was funny. Apparently, I think Susan is married to the ex-Beach Boys drummer, but she just throws in that he gets unemployment. I don't know why that's funny.
I saw that, yeah. He also gets unemployment.
Good for him. But what I like here, after Frank has found out that these guys have way more shows than he has, way more success than he has, he gets kind of desperate here.
At our age, it's good to be doing anything. You know, and yes, doing something you love. And also, by the way, now I'm in the liquor business. I have Uncle Frank's bourbon.
God. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, cinnamon. I got to tell you.
By the way,
it's doing great.
You guys may be doing all these tours, but I have a bourbon. Yeah, it's doing great. Ryan still hasn't gotten it, but it's doing great.
Dude, still waiting shipment. They have taken my money.
I can't even believe it.
I don't think I'm ever getting it. My intention is to come to Philly in the summer of 2025 in a year. I might have to buy my own bottle and just cut my losses with.
Has he made the connection that you're Ryan from this podcast and he put a stop on your shipment?
It's called thievery. You can't steal from me. You know, why do you don't like me, but you're not allowed to steal. You can't just take my money and not give me the product I bought. Oh, man. The next scene here is Frank admits something, which is kind of sad here. He kind of admits something.
I think I have the same note.
And, you know, and you were talking about, you know, you'd have this big hit and then you'd have, you know, all of a sudden you thought you were clicking and it didn't. So now you've got Stallone Frank that is out. Are you feeling any different?
5 years ago.
They ask him some pretty embarrassing questions that this just shows you they don't know Frank at all, right? Because this is why Frank needs to come on our show. We know more about Frank than the Cowsills do, than the Rob Fletcher podcast does, than the, what was the other one we did?
Fletcher's that guy, and Mike Torshi is the fucking Freddy Krueger, the demon from hell.
You know, I'll give the Cowsills full credit. They have natural old faces. I love it. They just,
yes.
And they look no normal. They just look older. That's fine.
All real. They're doing their thing. I respect it.
I respect it, too. You know, they have not messed up their faces with any plastic, just aged naturally. You don't know them very well because they mention, you had one hit. Nothing ever happened after that, which is true. Everyone knows that. And then you had the documentary, Stallone Frank, that is. That was, like you said, like 4 or 5 years ago. What are you doing now, Frank, is basically the question.
This is my favorite line of the podcast. Different
vibe? Or are you getting more shows? You know, how's that work for you?
I don't work early at all. I mean, that's why I started bourbon.
That's the soundbite. That is the soundbite. We both had the same thing because that's a soundbite. I don't work hardly at all.
I don't work hardly at all. He looked at his bourbon. Did you catch that? He quickly looked at his bourbon. He says, that's why I'm doing the bourbon. It's some sort of income. He has no income. Dom, you can't pay him if he's not doing anything.
Right. He's got to be living off Sly, right? I mean,
I don't know. His net worth says he's between 4 and 5 million, depending on the source. That's his net worth. So maybe real estate.
What could he really be getting? Even the movie roles, he's been in very small movie roles. So the residual checks and stuff like that can't be.
Even
big.
His music's died down. Like right. Like you don't keep getting money from music just because it existed. Like you have to get royalty checks, but Spotify downloads. I mean, those
and artists are struggling. Like big artists struggle with that. So what is he getting from Spotify?
Yeah, like artists like U2, Coldplay, Bruce, and Billy Joel, like they're not like living large off their airplay. It's
no,
for tours.
Definitely not.
Well, it's for tours now. It's tours. They'll tell you that.
That's where you make the money. Uh-huh.
So yeah, to Frank's credit, he has to have a secondary income, which is his meat sticks and his vodka.
Meat sticks.
So the question is asked later here, how come you suck? That was basically the did you get that question? Seriously.
What do you think the cause is? Like, look, we're
trying to figure it out.
Yeah, we're trying to figure it out. So do you think it's just, are you not ambitious? Are, you know, do we care more about our personal lives than our?
No, I'm really ambitious.
Oh man, this is like an ongoing theme throughout the podcast. They keep trying to find out. We used to be something we're not anymore. How come? So the Cowsills keep asking these questions about themselves. They're asking it to Frank, like, you're another washed up music artist. Let's combine our histories to figure out why we're both washed up. And she goes, is it because you're not ambitious? And she caught herself. Did you notice how she stopped mid ambitious and said, oh, is it because you care more about your families? Which she should have known. No, he hates his brother and he doesn't have a wife or kids. So it's not that at all. Frank Stallone might be the most selfish artist out there. There's nobody but him. He does not have a family. She caught herself about the ambitious, but then she catches herself with the family thing. But then she doesn't realize he doesn't have one because she doesn't know Frank very well. So Frank said, well, no, I am ambitious. I just suck. That has to be the only reason. Let's see what he says. He goes, no, I am ambitious.
I didn't get into this to make money. I got into it because...
Well, mission accomplished. Now, that's what people say when they're not successful.
Right.
Well, what do you call it? Placate yourself. Do you think, again, Billy Joel says, I never got into this for the money. No, he's worth hundreds of millions of dollars. He doesn't have to say that. He doesn't even have to say it. It doesn't matter. He's worth that anyways.
I think this goes into what my note was because he brings up his old glory days still living in the past. He says he won the battle of the bands in high school.
Yeah, I know. What is that? Can you imagine every band that won Battle of the Bands was popular? There'd be so many. There's so many of those Battle of the Bands throughout the U.S. alone. Like, there'd be thousands of bands that would be popular if just because they won their local high school contest.
Right.
There was something I could do, and I loved it. I mean, I didn't get into it. I was one of those little kids go, oh, God, I'll make all this money. We just wanted to meet girls and have a good time.
Yeah, and then I knocked one up, and I never speak to my son.
Yeah. What the hell, Frank?
I know. Did we mention that they bumped into each other? Did we talk about that event? Did we mention it? Did we have
a after the system? Podcast? After we did the podcast?
I just can't remember that Rob got a hold of me. And they like. So Frank and Mike were at that event that Rob was at, some premiere of a documentary.
And
Frank walked by his son 10 times and gave him the cold shoulder, didn't talk to him.
Wow.
I'm sorry, but to me, like, I'm speaking as a father, Frank. So if you're listening, this is me speaking as a father. That's a dick move. It's your son.
Yeah.
There's nothing my son could ever say about me. Nothing. He can make all the jokes about me. He can slander me. I will make every effort to reach out. I don't care until my son actually says, Dad, never speak to me again. But Rob's not saying that. Somebody else is saying, never speak to me again. That's my philosophy. I don't know. I could be. Maybe I'm a weird dad. Maybe I'm weird that way.
No, I don't think so.
Okay.
Be good and have our friends say, wow, the band's good. We won the battle of the bands when I was in high school. So that was my thing. But I think I never, I don't know. I never had good management. And I never had a good agency. And I've done 81 movies.
There we go. That was my next note. I've done 81 movies, not 60 movies, fucking Coswell. I've done 81 fucking movies.
Whatever your name is. Cowsills, Coalsills.
Cowbell, whatever your name is. I've done 81, so get it fucking 81 right.
81 movies. That 81st movie better be Veterans Day. We're waiting for that.
I think it probably is.
And
wow.
I never had that.
What you do if have.
You guys would have been like the Eurythmics, it'd be a whole different scene.
Right.
You know, if you have had like this, all these, you know, people behind you, like all the
records. At that time.
Oh, that's what it was. So he's talking about, I'd be successful if I had fans.
Yeah, well, everybody would be.
Now, he explains his nails. Did you make a note about the nails?
Oh, yes, I did make a note. And it's even more unsettling that he says they're fake. They're fake.
They're fake nails. So he does have long nails. So what makes it even worse and gross, Dom, yes, is that they're fake.
Yes. And, I got sick on stage once, and they fired me.
Oh, sorry.
I had pneumonia. I almost.
So, yeah, he talks about how some gig fired him because he was sick, but he thinks it's because he was conservative and has some conservative ideals. If I'm a venue holder and I'm a liberal and I have, what's his name, Ted Nugent? And yes. he can sell at my venue. I don't care.
Yeah, why would they care?
If I was a conservative and you had Bruce Springsteen at my venue, sell it out, brother. I'm going to take the money home from the venue, you know, because you're paying me for the venue. So they don't care what you are, Frank. They want seats in the venue. That's all they care about.
Frank,
yes,
can
ma'am.
I ask you a question?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you play flamenco or classical guitar?
I play nylon string guitars, yeah.
And do you pick with your fingernails?
Yeah, that's why you see my long fingernails.
Yes, I sent a picture to our drummer, Russ, because I like to always document who we have, and I take a little shot of the screen, right?
So that's why she takes the photos, is to document who they have on the air. I mean, you could just look at the titles of the episodes that you have, and then you know.
Yes, I wear women's fingernails to play guitar.
Oh, yeah.
Like all the great guitar players.
That's so weirdly odd.
Weird.
And Russ, just my husband asked, does Frank Stone play classical or flamenco?
Frank Stone? Okay. I don't know who that is.
Guitar. Specific fingernail trim.
I play with my fingers, nails, and yes, they are fake because I always break them.
So weird.
Now, wait a minute. Don't fake nails break easier than real nails? Am I wrong?
Yeah, it's the whole thing is unsettling that he fucking puts fake nails on and plays guitar. I've seen a lot of great guitarists and I've never seen anybody play with their fake fingernails on. That's weird.
It's kind
Frank,
of
what is your favorite genre? You do so many different genres of music. I've heard them all. I got to keep going back to Salon, Frank. That was the funnest show. You know, I mean, I feel bad for you sometimes in it because
I feel bad for you sometimes because your career is shit, but you know, so it was very entertaining.
That's Paul talking. He brings up that documentary three or four times. One, because I think that's the only thing that's his research. He did the research. He watched the documentary recently, enjoyed it. It's again, great documentary directed by Derek Wayne Johnson, friend of the show. Great guy. Man, I wish I could tell you stories. I can't. I have to do it off air. That's all I'll say. Derek had the privilege. I'll say Derek had the privilege of working with Frank Stallone. Yeah, there you go. I guess there's a question coming up here about how do we fix this? How do we fix your career, Frank?
But boy, it was sure fun to watch your history go. It was incredible.
Yeah, the history, it's a long one. They said I'm still the most famous unknown person in Hollywood.
Who's they? I've never heard that. Have you ever heard?
I've never heard that.
Okay. He talks about how something else wrecked his career. You get that note?
Oh, yes. I think that's my next note. I didn't want you to miss that one.
First, he didn't have a manager. Then he didn't have people behind him. He didn't have fans. And now there's another reason why his career never took off. This might explain his lack of love for these people.
Favorite genre of music to do, though, Frank?
He wanted to ask
that. I would say that's why we were talking about Happy Together. I love pop music. I love great tunes. I love harmonies. Cool. I like, you know, I think music's supposed to lift us up and not lift us down, put us down.
Yeah.
And I like doing the big band stuff because it's just like.
You're good at it.
Thank you.
I just got to chill on my left side.
Cool.
That's a heart attack.
She said, I just got to chill up my left side.
That's weird. What a weird. This is all weird. This whole thing is bizarre world, man.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But he's going to talk quickly here. Sorry, I thought I had it lined up better. But yeah, he's going to talk about which music. He's talking about all the different music that he enjoys, all the genres that he enjoys. Right. But there's one that he feels brings you down.
Yeah.
And I think what really hurt my career after Staying Alive, all of a sudden, like, rap and hip hop came in. And obviously, I went from working with Harry Nilsson.
Okay, I know. It's absolutely okay. Dom, I didn't even bother Googling it. Rap became big in the 80s with Run DMC and what have you. It became very popularized. I was raised in the 80s. I didn't listen to rap. It wasn't my thing. Like I just didn't listen to it. I was aware of it. And I knew, of course, NWA and Ice-T and all that stuff. But the point is the bands I was listening to, Aerosmith, Guns N' Roses, Motley Crue, Metallica, Megadeth, nothing was destroyed by rap. The world's a big place. There were rap fans, rock fans, pop fans, country fans, nothing got destroyed because of rap.
Like it still is. I mean, not everybody listens to rap, just like not everybody listens to rock. So
you had to be better than what was around you in your genre. That's it.
Another favorite line from this podcast is my quote is rap killed Frank Stallone's career.
Yeah. And he didn't have a manager or fans.
Brilliant man. He was gave my on the spot. Sign this. And I signed away my publishing.
Oh, yeah, I got
this. I have my writers, but not my publishing. And that's same terrible. Same thing happened. Well, it's happened to everybody. It happened on Staying Alive. I go,
it hasn't happened with everyone. So again, he's saying another reason why he doesn't have any money is because he signed away his publishing rights.
Mm-hmm.
I guess he doesn't get royalty checks. I think that's what happens. Am I wrong about that?
But he said he's got some other rights. He passed a comment. I don't know how it works with the music industry, but he's got something. He said he retained, but you know, what are the royalties? Like we talked about.
I won't play it again just because we want to make sure we get through all of our notes here. But he says again later that he didn't have a manager. He brings that up again. He didn't have a manager. I've got a note here. I don't know what was said, but it was, are you done, is my note. So let's just see.
I only ask this because you sounded so good at the California Music Hall of Fame, but do you perform at all ever? Are you done?
Yeah.
Are you done? Is this it? So he's saying, that, remember we played a little bit of that song that he played? Remember he couldn't find which mic to play at? That was
Yeah. He was going to different mics.
They're like, wow, you sounded really good. So are you done? Now listen to this answer, folks. Okay, let me just say this for back. Okay, listen to his answer, but I'm going to give you some history because I think it's important to hear how he does this word salad here, because he is done. He has not played Dom. He has not played a show since that Atlantic City show in September 2022.
That's the one when Sly came.
That's right.
And he refers to that and he says that one was sold out. That's because Sly came.
That's right. His show before that was like 5 years. And before that, it's he has played maybe 10 gigs in 10 years.
The gaps are getting bigger. The gaps
are getting bigger. So the question is valid. Are you done? Oh, no. Oh, no. Don't you worry, folks. Lots more Frank. Tickets are everywhere. Tickets are selling out fast.
Oh, yeah. No. We played like the Hard Rock in Atlantic City.
2 years ago, Frank. One show. But let's see what's on the horizon.
Last gig I did at the Hard Rock, we sold out. It was myself and John Cafferty.
And Sylvester Stallone.
Doesn't mention his brother that they were selling the tickets based on Sly Stallone's going to be there.
Of course they were. He was going to be in the crowd, introduce Frank for the reality show. Absolutely.
Eber Brown. And now we're going to go out with myself and Survivor. We're going to call it the Music and Movie Tour.
Hey.
Right. They had a lot of hits and movies, and I had a lot of hits and movies, and we're good friends. Frankie Sullivan, you know, who wrote all the hits, Eye of the Tiger. We're like,
okay, yeah, good luck on that tour. That tour is not going to go well, and it's not going to sell. He mentions later, I don't know if I marked it, we'll get to it if we get to it, but he does say later that nothing's really set in stone yet at the same time.
Yeah, this is him just talking. There's no tour dates or anything like that.
They mentioned later about this artist named Gary Lewis and that he performs even though he doesn't have to because he's got so much money, he doesn't have to perform. So I Googled his net worth is Gary Lewis, $5 million. now this one, did you make note about this one, about this artist and his son?
Okay. What time stamp is that?
1 hour, 10 minutes.
No, I don't have that.
Okay, check this out. This is very telling. I think I forget which artists are talking about, so bear with me, folks. So they're talking about an artist here, and Frank kind of slags the artist because he doesn't have a very good relationship with his son.
Oh, he says that. Oh, wow.
Yeah, do you know how many hit records Gary Lewis and the Playboys had?
Like, he did 3 or 4 times more than the rest of us. Snuff Garrett had a lot to do with those hits. They knew what to do with this guy, and there was hit after hit after hit. It's unbelievable. Oh,
yeah. And again, he had his problems because his father was very mean to him. His mother was his manager, you know, and so he said, yeah, my father was like really jealous of me. I go, me, Jerry Lewis was jealous of his 17-year-old son.
Holy crap. Talk about calling the kettle black. Frank has literally told his son, Rob, like, well, you're going to movies. What gives you the right to go to movies? The movies didn't work out for me. Why do you think I'm going to? Wow. So he's calling out someone else for being jealous of their own son. The hypocrisy knows no bounds. It's insane. Frank's calling out someone being jealous of their son and how that's not very cool. Yes, Frank, I couldn't agree more.
Not cool.
They have a big hot take. I won't play it, but they talk about how Karen Carpenter, people forget she was a good drummer. That's all people talk about. And her eating disorder. She's a good drummer. her E disorder, and she could sing. I think it's in that order. Okay, this is kind of funny. They're talking about the Doors, and they're talking about how Ian Astbury played with the Doors there. Right. Ian Astbury's the singer from The Cult, one of my favorite uh-huh. bands. And he did a stint with the Doors, remember, which was great. He did a great job.
I remember that back in the day, yeah.
I know, it was already like 20-odd years ago. But what I love is how Frank compliments Ian singing, but he doesn't say he sounded good like Jim Morrison.
Mm-hmm. But they sounded, but he looked exactly like him on stage. He looked as good as Val Kilmer did when he did the Doors.
He looked and sounded as good as Val Kilmer did, who was playing Jim Morrison. Why would you just say that Ian Astbury sounded and looked as good as Jim Morrison? Why the roundabout? Why involve Val Kilmer in that equation? It's like Val Kilmer did a great job channeling Jim. So Ian Astbury did a good job channeling Val Kilmer, who channeled.
Exactly.
I'm sorry, I just thought that was kind of a funny workaround.
And the funny thing is, yeah, you do it a lot. Like, you've done your songs a million times. But when you see the audience reaction, because it's new to them, they've never
That's
seen
it. Yes.
And That's they go, it. Oh, my God, it sounds just like the record. And they get really excited.
He is amazed that live artists can sound as good as the record, if not better. It's almost like Frank doesn't understand how live shows work. It's almost like he doesn't have enough exposure to them. This isn't a new thing for people.
All of it. That's what keeps us coming back, Frank. That's, I mean, we're not making $1,000,000,000. We do this because we hang out, provides us to hang out with each other, and because it brings us joy.
Again, they have to, what do you call it? When you lower your expectations, they're, what do you call that? It's a term. Excuse my brain, but they're lowering their expectations of their success. We don't do it for the money. We do it because we get to hang out as a family and get to play in front of 3-4 fans at a festival. Like, I understand what you're saying. You can have that too, but if our podcast actually got listeners, of course I'd be excited by that. I always try to provide a product that will get those listeners, but to say that that doesn't matter, of course it matters to a degree. If nobody listened, I would stop.
Mm-hmm.
Right, just like Frank has stopped doing gigs because nobody shows up. That's the honest truth. No, that's the honest truth. People aren't showing up. They're not showing up. Remember, he did have tickets for that one gig and it got canceled because there wasn't enough tickets sold.
Yeah, that one that I was supposed to go to.
Yeah,
and we were fortunate enough to have been who we are.
You have never going to give you up too, though. I mean, that
never
is
going to give you up.
Yeah.
Come on, that's almost more.
I didn't miss the question. I'm sorry.
You did miss the question, but I thought we were just going with it there.
Oh, my apologies.
He was answering it. The first part you played, he was answering it. So.
My apologies. Okay, so no, I missed the question. So, yeah, the answer was, okay, that's right. Okay, so he's saying, yes, people are thrilled that the live version sounds just as good as his
right.
one. Okay, my apologies, Dom.
No, you
did. Okay, now, are we tracking all the reasons why he wasn't successful? Because I have one more.
I got the other one, too.
Pain alive that killed Frank Stallone's career.
We have no managers, no agency, no fans, rap music,
and Barry fucking Gibb.
Far From Over's out. It's a huge record, and I'm on a roll. And we're saying, okay, let's get Never Going to Give You Up out right away. But the Bee Gees, which I hold nothing against them, I'm like the biggest Bee Gee fan in the world. I mean, I think I saw them years ago, way before Saturday Night Fever, and they were just unbelievable sounding. So I'm a fan. But for some reason, there was something in the contract where they had to release their second record, and it died. And so the momentum of me, you know, 8-10 weeks is a long time. You know, the record.
See, yeah.
So Never Gonna Give You Up came out. It was kind of more like AOC. But it would have been a great follow-up to that. You know what I mean?
Okay, so isn't that interesting? It took me about 5 times to figure out what he's trying to say here. He's talking about the momentum of the Bee Gees and the disco sound and all that stuff, whatever the Bee Gees would bring to the table with the album that he did, that Never Gonna Give You Up, with the duet with that lady.
Right.
Interesting how he's blaming the Bee Gees' failure of an album to his failure, where he's saying, I was hoping and expecting to ride on the coattails of that band. But he refuses to acknowledge the coattails his brother's given him.
Right.
So he's blaming the Bee Gees' lack of momentum on a follow-up album to kind of stifling the sound of his song, which stifled his career as well. he wants it every which way. It's never his product. It's all these extraneous things that are happening around him that have caused the lack of his career. Mm-hmm. There was some big gaps in this where Lott was just, it was very boring talk. In fact, they wanted to end the show at one point.
But yeah, Frank, yeah. All right, we don't want to keep Frank all day. And he's like, no, I'm staying. I got nothing else going on.
Yes, exactly. So that happened about 10 minutes ago. So we're nearing the end of the podcast, end our episode, folks. He, again, believe it or not, Dom, he contradicts himself. He talks about how Kid Rock can't get canceled.
It doesn't matter. They have their fans are going to go. And they always said, I'll never be in Rolling Stone. But he doesn't care. He just goes out and does his thing. And it's a great show.
They're talking about Kid Rock.
Kid Rock, right.
And the reason why you can't cancel him, do you want to guess why?
Because his fans are always going to be there.
Exactly. Exactly. That's why you can't cancel Donald Trump. That's why you can't cancel Joe Rogan. Can't cancel Dave Chappelle, Bill Burr. There's certain people you can't cancel no matter what. Even C.K. Lewis, he's selling out. Like, people don't want to talk about it. He's selling out where he goes right now. You know that, right? Like, he's selling out everywhere. Mm-hmm. When you have fans, Dom, you can't be canceled. So, again, it's funny how Frank is acknowledging this, the reason why Kid Rock is successful despite rap, despite the Bee Gees. It's because he plays good music that people enjoy. You don't have to like his music, but the reason why he is who he is because people go to his shows and he does a good show. It's just funny how he doesn't almost know what he's saying. He's actually telling an actual truth here. The reason why he can't cancel Kid Rock is because he has fans.
He just constantly contradicts himself.
He does bring up again here the tour. He plugs his tour.
Oh, yeah. She asks, is the Survivor tour going worldwide?
Yeah, okay. We'll get to that part. But right now, he brings up the tour name. He plugs again his past hard rock shows.
Stallone Survivor, Survivor Stallone.
I love how he said it's going to be called Stallone Survivor. Yeah, or Survivor Stallone. We haven't quite figured out the bill.
He probably hasn't even told Survivor about this tour.
This part's very telling. This is very subtle. I'm starting to really understand Frank's way of speaking. He talks about past shows that he's played at and the type of audience he plays in front of. And it dawned on me, Dom. The
Oklahoma show, right?
Yes. And he's talked about this before. Remember when he says like people came up to, he talked about it on the Mike Torsia show where people would come up to him afterwards. Hey, that was actually pretty good. It dawned on me that he's not playing to his fans. He's playing gigs that people are at, i.e. casinos.
Right.
Yes. People aren't buying tickets to see Frank. They're buying tickets to eat at somewhere, to play cards somewhere.
And he's hired as a musician. Right.
That's right. He basically exposes that right here.
Well, you know what? I figure my theory is go where they love you, man.
So nowhere.
Yes. Well, that's what I mean. It's like he has had a gig in 2 years. So, okay. That's pretty, pretty telling.
So stay home.
And then the other thing he says, go where they love you. And also what he meant to say is go where they pay you.
All right.
You know what? It doesn't matter. I played a gig in Miami, Oklahoma at the Buffalo Run Casino.
Miami, Oklahoma.
Oh, this is so embarrassing, Dom. He played a gig at some Buffalo casino in Florida.
In the middle of nowhere.
And this is where you know he's not playing in front of his fans because people that are in the crowd have this to say.
So I'm there. Well, I said, do you think they'll like what we're doing? He goes, well, we'll do a meet and greet. I said, okay. Sitting out the, you know, in the audience, guys with like caterpillar hats, like, you know, with like nugget jewelry, like wearing coveralls, like, oh boy. Anyway, we got like an ovation. They loved it because my theory is Sinatra said, just do your show. Don't alter your show. Do your show the best you can. And I goes, well, meet and greet. I said, well, how do I know who the high rollers are that you want me to meet? Now, this is in the middle of nowhere. He goes, probably the guy with the less teeth. And the gold.
I don't even know what the hell he's talking about.
Yeah.
So he's talking about a meet and greet was set up. He had a standing ovation, but then only the high rollers are going to meet him, I guess. I don't know. Like, why does it matter who the high rollers are? I'm sorry, Frank. I'm not a high roller. So if I come up to you and say, good show, you're not going to speak to me because I have all my teeth.
To in the back, I said, was this guy, does he work here? Is he like a custodian? He goes, Frank, he's the highest roller in the whole casino. Guy's sitting there. Yeah. Well, so I like
you. Oh, boy. Great story. That's a great story.
Crazy. It's a horrible story. I don't think they've ever heard a story before. All right. Now we've got news about the Survivor Tour. I think you had that as well.
Yes.
So are we going to see you this summer, Frank Stallone? Are you going to come see us somewhere?
Yeah, if you're nearby, if you
I love that.
That's like he's letting her down easily.
You gotta come see us a tour. Well, sure, if you play in my backyard, I guess I'll open the window and look outside. Do I have to leave my living room? Can I watch it on TV? Or
sure.
Where's
I'll find where you're
Costa
playing.
Costa Mesa ain't nearby, and neither is Humphrey.
Costa Mesa's not bad.
It's pretty great.
Is your Survivor tour going all over the country?
Well, we're going to look for that. Start at the Hard Rocks and get it going.
You're gonna really need to look for that one.
Oh, man.
Get on your fucking microscope to look for that one.
Dom, if they come to New York, are you going to see Survivor Stallone?
I will take one for the team and I will see it. Yes, I will. As a co-host of what's become the Frank Stallone podcast, I think it's my obligation to go see him and come back to you and give you a full report.
If it lines up for my summer 2025 visit, I'll come see him.
Imagine.
Yeah.
My God.
I have here, it's titled Delusions of Grandeur. I can't remember quite what he said here.
You know what I think? You know, people go, well, if I do 40 shows, I go, that's actually 120 days, because usually, I don't know about you, I don't trust the airlines. I go in the day before, do the show, and leave the next day.
Yeah.
So basically, one day is 3 days.
So he's talking about his tour schedule. Again, that does not exist. So he says, if I have 40 gigs in a year, it's really 120 days because it's the day before and the day after. So he's busy for 120 days for 40 gigs. So I think that was my delusions of grandeur, where he's talking about things that don't exist for him.
So 50 shows is like 150 days a year.
Last clip, folks, is the Family Stallone plug. One last plug.
And Frank, we are your supporters. We're going to talk big about you because we've heard you sing, and man, we're fans.
You know what? Would it be fun for you to watch on the bus if you do get Amazon?
This is funny. Okay, so he talks about, first he says Amazon Prime, but it's on Paramount Plus.
They say the best is, then she says Netflix. So they say like the three wrong things before they say the right one. So like nobody knows where to find this show.
And what I love is that they didn't even know he had a show. They had no idea. How could you not know? Like, honestly, they don't know Frank Stallone from anybody, man. And Susan's like, what? You have a reality show?
I mean, if you get
Netflix
Plus, the second season of Family Stallone.
Oh,
it's our second season. And it's my.
They don't know what he's talking about.
They're going to ask him what kind of phone calls scenarios he does to get that show.
They literally spent the first half hour of their show before Frank come on talking about how they can make a reality show. Right. Frank's actually now telling them, I'm actually on a reality show. Would you like to pick my brain at all? They don't ask one proper question about how to do a reality show with Frank here as an expert. That's what I'm getting at. They have no idea who Frank is. They literally should have said throughout the interview, hey, man, we were approached by reality. What's it like to be on a reality show? How does it work? How do they do things with you guys? What kind of scenarios do they put you in? Totally missed opportunity by the Cowsills to use Frank. And Frank would then get the plug his show and sound like the expert that he is regarding the reality shows and how they work. And the Cowsills could learn something. But at the end of this episode, with 2 minutes left, they're now just learning. We could have had this plethora of information and we've lost it all.
My brother, myself, and my three nieces. And of course, I am like, since I'm the uncle that's single, I'm like Ed Norton or Kramer. I'm the one throwing a monkey wrench into the works. You know what I mean? My nieces are like, dude, lock. I can't find a guy. I go, ah, so what? You know what I mean? So
you have a reality show with your.
Oh, my gosh. Yes. Welcome to the program, Susan. Season 2, Paramount Plus. They do not know Stallone's career at all.
Brother and your nieces.
Oh, yeah.
Telling our audience this as we're saying goodbye.
Remember, I was telling you the one.
You're number one.
Can everyone stop talking, please? I can't hear a word.
We're all yelling at each other. You have a reality show?
Look at Paul. He's just got that dopey grin the whole time. He's just got that dopey.
Yeah, there's our second season on Paramount Plus.
I saw the episode, Frank, where the girls were talking about your panic episodes, to be candid. And that was very, I just seeing you with the girls like that, Uncle, and hearing all this Uncle Frank stuff was great.
Well, the one you got to see is where my brother, we're in Italy. My brother said, hey, you got to wear these Speedos. I said, I'm not wearing Speedos, but they were like a size too small. So The girls are there with the makeup. You know, they're, you know how girls are that young, you know, everything, you know, locked.
Everywhere.
So I grabbed one of the falls that they were going to put on, and I stuck it in my Speedos. So I've got like this, like.
It's very disturbing.
That's
a very disturbing scene. He's got hair coming out of his Speedos.
Oh, God.
Is that hilarious, Don? This is content.
Wait, you don't make any phone calls, Frank? What kind of phone calls?
Okay, well, that's it, folks. I can only hope that Frank goes on another podcast, but I think we're all caught up. He did the Torsia show, the Burchett show, whatever that guy was, the Cowsills show. I think we got them all. He's making the rounds, promoting.
We're following the Frank Stallone podcast tour.
His Instagram is not as busy as it once was, so who knows? Maybe the next episode will cover episode 4 of the Ramble cartoon if he doesn't give us any content. So,
will Ryan ever get his bourbon is the real question.
I'm not even trying to be funny. I truly believe they stole from me. They took my money. And I'm not going to see that bourbon until I buy my own bottle somewhere in New York or Philly when I go visit.
Crazy.
Summer 20. If they're still in stock then, if they haven't like shut down shop.
I haven't seen them in any stores around me, but I also haven't been looking. I got to check if there's any.
It's a ripoff, man.
And nobody's even answering you?
They have a automatic chat, you know, like a chat window on their site where you can. No one answered that one. Said, hey, I'm just curious. I messaged them on Instagram and I've sent an email. I kid you not. Nothing.
Wow.
Think about that for a second, Dom. It's a business. Email, Instagram, and your bot chat. No responses. I look for a phone number. Nothing to call.
Three ways for them to not answer you, essentially.
That's horrible business. That's a horrible business practice. So I know you haven't drank yours yet. I know you're waiting.
It's waiting.
I'm sorry, man. I just keep waiting. Just do it for me.
I'm in no rush. I'm in no rush to drink the Frank Stallone bourbon.
So the question is, what will happen first? Me getting my Frank bourbon or us finishing the Frank content? What will happen first? I always think it's over, you know. I guess it is far from over because... But I will say again that his Instagram content has diminished a bit since he saw our podcast with Rob. Do the two have to do with the other? I don't know, but it's a reality that did happen.
Knowing Frank, I don't think it would stop him. I think he's probably maybe just busy with other stuff. He'll be back. Frank will be back.
True. He's busy delivering Frank.
I don't work much at all.
That was actually a better podcast than I hoped. That was fantastic. Between the Cowsills and their antics and Frank, it was. I would watch their show every week if they were together. I would.
That's a chore right there.
Right, Dom, as always, it's a pleasure to be with you and to do the show with you.
Oh.
Before we close, folks, we got an email.
Surprise.
Send us emails. Send the email. Still the same email address, rambleseriespodcast@gmail.com. That's rambleseriespodcast@gmail.com. We do got an email. This is from Peter. He says, hey, Ryan and Dom, you're both endlessly entertaining and hilarious. He said, this is possibly the most comedic podcast I personally know of.
Right.
Wow. That's a high praise. Either he doesn't listen to very many or they're just not very funny. He goes, I especially enjoyed the Frank Stallone son, Robert episode. Yes, that was a highlight episode. He says, Robert appears to be well-adjusted, mature, and a noble young man. Yes, all the things that Frank is not. Frank is neither well-adjusted, mature, or young, or noble. He goes on to say, I hope you both have the stamina and perseverance to continue this awesome podcast. Regards, Peter, Australia. What do you think, Dom? I would say it's up to Dom, because that's not fair to Dom. But if Dom says, Ryan, I'm done... It'd be hard for me to keep going without Don.
I'm done.
Well, I don't know. How are you doing?
Good. I'm good. You know, I'm seeing how far the Frank Stallone coverage goes. Organically, it'll just, it'll either abruptly end.
Right, of course. And I'm the same way in that. Yeah, we'll see kind of where it goes. Naturally, he guessed it on this podcast, for example. So we'll see what happens in 2 weeks. If what his Instagram content is like, we might just do a Rambo Instagram combination episode. So stand by for that, folks. So
and then you still got to get your whiskey. So that's the farewell.
That's the fair fat. That will be the last kind of last episode will be the whiskey tasting, bourbon tasting episode. But that being said, thank you so much for everyone for watching. Keep watching our shows. So yeah, if you see a Rambo episode, check it out, because even if it's just the cartoon episode, because on those episodes, we do a double bill. We put Frank on those as well. They'll be labeled the Rambo cartoon, but Frank's on them. So if you're listening to this episode, go back and listen to all of season 5 of the Rambo podcast, mm-hmm. because every single episode is a Frank story, a Frank coverage. But Dom, with that.
That concludes another episode of Frank Stallone, Who Is This Guy?